Well, good morning, everyone. We want to welcome you to the services of South Swansea Baptist Church this morning. Would you stand with me, please? I'll draw your attention to the screen as we sing our opening hymn, At the Cross.
Thank you. Good morning, South Swansea.
Good morning.
How's everyone doing today?
Good.
It's a beautiful day, a little windy, but a nice day finally after some rain. Just a few things I just want to mention. Following our service this morning at 8:30, we have the FBT, the Fellowship Bible Time. We have the men up here as well as the ladies downstairs. So you're welcome to come out and join us for an in-depth more of a Bible study where we dig a little deeper into God's Word. Also this evening, we have our church call to prayer. We always have it at the first Sunday of the month, and that'll be at 6 p.m. this evening. Also on Mondays, we have our ASL class. That's 9:15 in the white building in the red room. Wednesday nights, as you guys know, we have our Bible study and prayer time, and just come out and join us. Pastor's doing a study on 1 Corinthians 10:13 and just kind of digging a little deeper into God's Word there, so it's been really a blessing on Wednesday night, so feel free to come out. And as well as we have downstairs, we have our blast with the kids, the teenagers, as well as the young kids next door, Junior Travelers and Sunshine Bunch. Also, Connie has a Bible study on Thursdays as well. She does it with the ladies at 9:30. They do it in the white building as well. But it's a little warmer there. They get the heat, so they're a little more comfortable. And then they do it at 7 o'clock at night on Zoom. So just keep that in mind. Also, we have some booklets. You're going to see some booklets today when you're leaving our service. They'll be in the back, like normally where we have our daily breads. And it's Easter, the Promise of Forgiveness. And it's basically 10 reflections from our daily bread. So the same company that provides us the daily bread provides us with these. So feel free as you're leaving this morning in the service, in the back, just grab them. And to kind of just segue into that, you know, as we know, next week is Resurrection Sunday, Easter Sunday. So Just keep in mind, we have the sign-up sheet in the back. We're only going to have one service, and that's going to be at 9:30 a.m., just a reminder. But prior to that service, we're going to have downstairs, we're going to have some fellowship and prayer time at 8:30. We're going to have some pastries, some refreshments, some fresh fruit, you know, and whatnot. And then about 9:15, we'll kind of shoot our way up here for the 9:30 service. So keep in mind 9:30, and feel free to invite someone. We live in a lost and dying world, and you know, and Jesus is the only way. You know, John 14:6 says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. You know, no one comes to the Father but through me." And in the world we live in, feel free to invite a brother, a sister, a family member, a friend, anyone to come out on Resurrection Sunday, because I'm pretty sure it will be a blessing this Sunday. And just, it's a reminder to those out there that, you know, Christ lives. You know, growing up Roman Catholic, you know, I used to always look at the cross at the Catholic Church, and I'd wonder, you know, it was a sadness, you know, because I'd say, oh, Jesus died. But as Christians, as evangelical Christians, we know the cross is empty because Christ is alive. He's not dead, you know, and that's always a reminder to me, you know, and it should be a reminder to those loved ones that, you know, do have other churches, and invite them to come out on Sunday. So feel free to do that, and that'll be, again, one service, and that'll be at 9:30 a.m. next Sunday. So that will close and for our offering, and the pastor will come up. Dear Lord, we just thank you once again for your word, Lord, and we thank you for gathering us here this morning to hear your word, to worship you, to fellowship with your people, Lord. Just open our hearts this morning to your message. We pray for our offering as well, Lord, that you just bless it. And we just thank you once again, Lord. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
And it's good to see you here in the house of the Lord as we have this opportunity to worship Him together. You might notice that this morning, I committed the unpardonable a little while ago, didn't I? Did you notice that? Did you notice when I said, we'll dismiss the kids, and I said, everybody else, let's go around and shake hands and greet one another in the name of the Lord? Everybody went, well, you know, next month it's all done, right? Next month, May 11th, yep, Pam, May 11th, it's going to be written that no more fear. So you'll be able to shake hands, and you'll be able to greet. Remember those days when we used to do that?
All right, I'm going to be quiet. I'll be quiet before I get myself in trouble. All right, well, we're so glad to see you here this morning, and praise the Lord on this Palm Sunday, and we're glad that you're here. Just share a few prayer requests with you and pray for these, and then if you would take your Bible and turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, we're going to begin in a moment with our communion. And then we'll turn to our scripture for our message this morning. Prayer request this morning. If you are on the email list for requests that go sent out that are sent out for prayer, you recently saw we sent out Grace Santos is in the ICU at Charlton Memorial Hospital. And Grace said to me the other day, she is tired. She is ready to go home. And of course, I remind her that we are selfish and we're not ready to see her go home. We'd love to see her back here continuing to worship with us, but it's not our call. And so we do commit her, as always, to God. And so we ask that you would pray for her there at Charlton Memorial. Jerry Bouchard of the Sarah Brighton home, get back from the hospital, back to the home, as they've been caring for his leg. Anna DeSilva, Dave's son, Kyle, thyroid cancer. He's going to be having his procedures with doctors soon. I have on my prayer request Judd Souza. When you came in this morning, who did you see standing back there? Judd Souza. Judd, good to have you back, man. Judd took a little hiatus, a little world tour. He's back with us now. Continue to pray for his health. The Lord will strengthen him. Matt Kozatek, recuperating from surgery. Continue to pray for Matt. Bev Oliver at home. Armin Ramos at home. Brother Tom, our piano player, will be going in for a cardiac procedure on Tuesday. So remember to pray for Tom in that procedure, and that the Lord allows him to be with us on Easter Sunday. We have some plans for music from him, so he's going to have to be back. Janine Tiffins, an unspoken request. And then also want to mention to you continued prayer for the Teets and Tetro families and the passing of Pam's Aunt Linda. And for just some information for you, Pam shared with me on Sunday 4/16. There'll be a visitation from 1 to 3 with a service at 3 at the Rock Funeral Home, 1285 Ashley Boulevard, New Bedford. And so please pray for the family all the way through, and especially during that time. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for this opportunity that we're able to be here in the house of God this morning to sing praise unto you, worship and thanksgiving for who you are and what you do. Today we come before you now as our Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals, is our great physician, and we lift up these whose names that we've mentioned, Grace and Jerry, Kyle, Judd, Matt, Bev, Armin, Tom, Janine, and the Teets and Tetro families. Father, we pray that your perfect will, plans, and purposes be done for each of these that we call out before you today. And we thank you for not only hearing our prayer, but the fact that you also answer prayer. Be with us, Lord, as we go into our service this morning, beginning with our time of communion before you. And we thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, reading beginning in verse 23. For I have received from the Lord
that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do ye as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup." Let's take a moment of silent reflection and examination this morning. Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Tom, would you pray, please? They took the bread and ate it. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do ye as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." Brother Lenny, would you pray for us, please? They took the cup and they did sup.
Let's sing this together.
Inadvertently put that screen up prematurely, and that was because of the string I forgot to put on my finger. That would have reminded me about the screen.
Take your Bible, if you would, with me, please. We're going to turn to the Old Testament book of Zechariah. Zechariah. You say, where is Zechariah? If you find Matthew in the New Testament and go back one, you come to Malachi. Go back another and you'll come to Zechariah. And we're going to be in Zechariah just briefly this morning. Zechariah chapter 9. Zechariah chapter 9. And we're going to read Zechariah chapter 9 and verse 9. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. Amen. Father, I ask in these next few moments that we spend together that you might speak to us from your word, that you might encourage us in you. I ask two things, that if there be one here this morning who does not know the Lord Jesus as their personal Savior, God, I pray that they would consider him today and his finished work on the cross of Calvary, giving his life as a payment of our sin, that all who trust in him by faith would have their sin forgiven in heaven, their home. Father, I pray for each of us who name the name of Christ, who know beyond any shadow of doubt that Jesus is ours and we are his. Father, would you speak a word into our lives this morning that we might love you more today than we did yesterday, and that we might have a heart to serve you each and every day we are here. Fill us with Holy Spirit power. Use us today, we pray, and we thank you for this. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, more than 2,000 years ago, God's plan of redemption changed our world forever. The power of sin, the power of death was broken through the crucifixion and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ on that first Easter. In fact, a time that a week from today, we will be celebrating what is considered to be the greatest day of the year for the child of God. Because it is a time that we come together and we recognize the fact, not only with our lips, but through the totality of our lives, who Jesus is. And that death was defeated, and true life, spiritual life, if you will, God's life, triumphed. And we rejoice in that fact. In fact, every single day. Now, the happenings of Palm Sunday, what we know as Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem, the holy city, they're all detailed for us in the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. It also marked what many think of as the beginning of Jesus' journey to the cross. And in reality, that journey began long before Jesus ever started his public ministry. You say, what do you mean? Well, that journey began before he arrived on earth, born as a babe in a manger in Bethlehem. And Jesus' purpose was part of a larger plan, even before the creation of the world. So Jesus' journey wasn't just about the immediate. It wasn't just about the here and now. But his journey is one that would make an impact on all eternity. His journey was not just about the earthly events that took place in Jerusalem. The true meaning of this journey is found in the spiritual realm. And by the way, if you think about it, it makes sense to us, doesn't it? Because now you're no longer in a worldly realm, or we may live here, but we are all about the spiritual realm, having been born again into the life of Jesus Christ, a life he's called us to live. And while this event that we look at this morning is marked the triumphal entry, Jesus' journey was not about human intention. His journey wasn't about human invention. It was one of obedience to his Father's will and the fulfillment of his Father's plan for redeeming the world. And how grateful we are for that. Because none of us as individuals or none of us collectively could have ever taken care of sin's hold on each of us. If we had to depend on ourselves, we would still be lost and undone and on our way to hell or a Christless eternity. So looking at what happened on that day in Jerusalem, there are three symbols that we share with you this morning that I believe can help us to remember the lessons of Palm Sunday. The three symbols would be this: a donkey, palm branches, some of which put out in front of you in paper form today, and rocks. Now, common things remind us, I believe, of the uncommon journey of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And so what we want to do in the beginning is focus attention on a donkey. What do you think of when you see a donkey? What do you think of when you see a donkey? I heard a couple of you. You know, when I think of a donkey, I think of the fact that they often keep to themselves. I mean, it's not like some kind of favorite pet, some animal that you can call and they just come up and nuzzle and all this. Nah, they really don't do that. When I think of a donkey, I'm also reminded that they can be very fixed in their ways. And then, amongst other thoughts, and somebody did say this answer moments ago, when I think of a donkey, I think of that animal as being very stubborn. Very stubborn. So they keep to themselves, they're fixed in their ways, they're stubborn, and they are those ways because that's what they're known for. That's how we know them. Now, when we think of Jesus making his triumphal entry into the holy city, I think this is a reasonable question to ask. And here it is. Why on a donkey? Why ride into the city on a donkey? Something that likes to keep to itself, something that is often fixed in its own way, and something that can be extremely stubborn. Now, I know if we take a deeper dive theology, and some of you out sitting in the congregation are already thinking, well, wait a minute, preacher, I know why. Yeah, we know why. But it might seem that Jesus riding into Jerusalem on a donkey could be considered by some as a practical matter. What do I mean a practical matter? Well, perhaps he was tired of walking, right? And there was something that he could set upon and he could ride. The donkey was nearby, perhaps, accessible, easily to just send somebody to go after, come and bring that to you. But the Bible informs us that Jesus riding the donkey on the donkey was part of God's bigger plan. There are often things that we see, and we're so grateful for the Word of God, that informs us oftentimes about God's bigger plan. Those things that we often come up against in life that we don't seem to know the answer for, we can't seem to figure out, and then we do a little bit of a deeper dive into the Word of God, and we see through the revelation of the Scripture, that completed canon of Scripture, God has a bigger
plan. I'm so grateful for that. I'm grateful as I think about the world that we live in and things that we see that God has a bigger plan. In the Older Testament book of Zechariah chapter 9 verse 9, we note the prophecy that the Messiah would come riding on a young donkey. We read that verse moments ago. Matthew, in the Gospels of Matthew, he quotes Zechariah in Matthew chapter 21. So rather than I read this off for you, quote it out, would you take your Bible and turn to Matthew chapter 21 with me? I want you to see this and hold your place in Matthew chapter 21. We'll be coming to it again in just a moment. But first of all, Matthew chapter 21, we're going to read verses 1 through 7. Now, when they drew near Jerusalem and came to Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them. Bring them to me. And if anyone says anything to you, you shall say, 'The Lord has need of them,' and immediately he will send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, 'Tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey,'" of which we just read in Zechariah chapter 9 and verse 9 when we began. Verse 6, "So the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them. They brought the donkey and the colt, laid their clothes on them, and set him on them. And a very great multitude spread their clothes on the road. Others cut down branches from the trees and spread them on the road." So what do we see in this text? Well, we read about it in Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. And Matthew quotes from Zechariah and gives us a little more information. And what we know as we refer to this first symbol being the donkey, that high-ranked Roman soldiers of Jesus' day often rode upon horses, often as a show of power, they would ride the horse. Often as a show of position, they would ride a horse. And these steeds not only spoke of power, but they also spoke of strength. They also spoke of authority. So riding into the holy city on a donkey, perhaps not so much. Perhaps not so much this picture of power. Not so much this picture of strength. And certainly didn't seem to be so much the picture of authority. So while the donkey can represent the humility of Jesus, and the donkey can also have a representation of peace, the irony of the story is that by riding a donkey into the holy city, Jesus is proclaiming a message. And the message is this, is that he is the Messiah and King. Now, what's so important about that? Well, the thing we understand about that is that this would establish a link to the past by fulfilling the prophecy of Zechariah, another prophecy that the Lord Jesus Christ fulfilled, as well as pointing to the future of the Lord Jesus, not as an earthly king. Not as an earthly king. And that's critical to understand at this point of all those who would gather around him. He comes not as the earthly king, but as the one true king who would reign forever, proving God's love. A one true king who would reign forever, proving God's forgiveness. And a one true king who would rule forever, proving both God's grace and his redemption. And so we see one of the symbols, a character, if you will, in this, as we seek to understand Palm Sunday, is the donkey. But that's not the only symbol we see. We also see the symbol of the palm branches. I want you to think about this for a moment. I found this illustration. I want to share it with you. Imagine you loaded your family into the family van. Your kids cheer loudly because you're driving toward the ice cream store and they can almost savor the goodness. But surprise, as you get close to the ice cream store, you not only are close to it, you drive past the ice cream store, to the airport and board a plane for a European vacation. You would think your kids would be ecstatic, right? No. You would think they'd enjoy the trip of a lifetime. But instead, your kids are more downtrodden, depressed, now crushed. They were so looking forward to ice cream. This wasn't what they expected. It didn't fit the idea of what should happen. And I think most of us in this room, I might be wrong, most of us in this room, I don't think, have a surprise trip to Europe planned. Skip? Not this week. Sorry, folks. The illustration does give us a glimpse into what happened to Jesus' disciples and his followers on Palm Sunday. And I want you to think about this. They were cheering with excitement. They were all thrilled. They thought their king had arrived. He was there. And in Matthew chapter 21, again, if you're at that place, verse 8, as they great multitude spread their clothes on the road, others cut down branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Then the multitudes who went before and those who followed cried out, saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And when he had come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, "Who is this?" So the multitude said, "This is Jesus, the prophet, the Nazareth of Galilee." What a picture here. The crowds gathering, waving their palm branches, representative of victory as they see their king riding in to the city. They spread their garments, their coats, their cloaks, their coverings on their road for their new king. Finally, their Messiah has come. Finally, their deliverer has come. Finally, he was going to overthrow their oppressors that they've been living under for the longest period of time. Finally, he would put in place the perfect kingdom for his people. However, the crowd would soon discover that he, Jesus, this king, wasn't what they expected. You know, I remember when I was a younger person, there was a show on television. I think it was on Sundays. It was related to sports. It was called The Wide World of Sports. And they would start their opening monologue with pictures, and they would have the music going, and the show would come on, and they would say, "The thrill of victory," and you'd see somebody, and then it would say, "The agony of defeat," and you'd see a fella crumble and fall all over. And interesting, these looking at Jesus, the thrill of victory, but Jesus wasn't there to set up an earthly political kingdom. By the way, he's not present here today to set up an earthly political kingdom. Through you, through me, through his church, parachurch ministries. He was a heavenly king. His victory, the ultimate victory over sin and death, would be more than freedom from their current oppression, their current persecution. It'd be a victory that would restore all creation and make a way for every person, every man, woman, and young person to come into a right relationship with God. He had come to defeat what no other individual could, to save our souls from sin and eternal separation from God. Isn't it interesting that none of them understood the extent of what Jesus was preparing to do? Even Jesus' disciples didn't get it. You say, how do you know that? Well, John gives us a little insight there in the Gospel of John. John chapter 12, verse 16, John wrote, "His disciples did not understand these things at first, but when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things were written about him and that they had done these things to him." Well, I don't know how this speaks to you, but the first question I write here is, what about you? What about me? What do we expect from Jesus on Palm Sunday? What will we expect from Jesus on Resurrection Sunday? What are we looking for in relation to His resurrection? Are we prepared for His power and victory in our lives? Or are we looking at something else? And the tendency when we look at something else is to forget His power and His victory in our life. And I think we could all stand and give testimony this morning that there are times in our relationship to Jesus we look for the wrong thing. We do it the wrong way. And then we wonder, God, how come you let me down? Jesus, how come you let me down? When He didn't let you down at all. But we need to look at Him in the right way, in the right thing, in the right working. So we have these symbols. We have the symbol of the donkey. Everybody would look and see him coming in on this little stubborn creature. Yet it's a picture of Jesus' humility. It also gives us a picture of peace. He doesn't ride in on this strong, powerful, mighty steed. And then we have these palms that we think about, that people waved in victory as they laid down their garments, believing that here's the one who's going to come, and He right now, today, is going to make all wrongs right. And that wasn't why He came. And then another reminder for us is the third symbol. It's the rocks. Palm Sunday is a picture that represents all of Jesus' life. It represents His love. It represents His sacrifice. It represents His commitment to fulfill the work that the Father gave Him to do. And when He rode into Jerusalem, He didn't arrive in order to gain approval. Jesus knew what was coming. He knew that soon He would die on a cross. He knew, isn't it interesting? Only days later, the same crowd that's crying out, Hosanna, Hosanna, and they're waving banners in victory and laying down their garments, He knew that just days later, the same crowd would shout, Crucify Him, crucify Him. Boy, people are so fickle. We can be that way too. And yet, moving from the victory chant to the crucified calling out, Jesus didn't change His mind. I'm glad Jesus didn't base His mission from the Father on polling data. Well, let me stop. Let me think. What do the polls say I should do? Aren't you glad? Jesus' purpose was not subject to human sanction or praise. In fact, in Luke 19, verses 37 through 40, listen to this. Then as He came, Jesus, now drawing near the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. And some of the Pharisees called to Him from the crowd, Teacher, rebuke your disciples. But He answered and said to them, I tell you that if they should keep silent, the stones would immediately cry out. Now, I have seen painted rocks. I've seen designer rocks. And I've known people who have owned pet rocks. But I have never, and I've never actually heard a stone cry out. I haven't seen that yet. And to me, that kind seems impossible in my human thinking. But that was Jesus' point. The importance of the day wasn't about who kept quiet and who sang the praises. It was about creation. starting with you and me. It was about creation, starting with us as image bearers of God needing redemption. It was about the whole creation bound by the curse of sin and death. It was about all of creation praising God when its creator was at work to lift the curse of sin and make the way of restoration for all he created. You say, well, how do you know that Palm Sunday, how do you know that's true? Because the plan of God began even before the formation of the world. You were in God's mind and heart from the very beginning. And all the way through your life. And you will be in God's mind and heart throughout all eternity. You see, Jesus' purpose was not to be liked by the majority. I mean, kind of, that's how kind of we are sometimes, right? Everybody likes to be liked. Right? And even the person that says, I don't care if they like me or not. Yeah, in the quietness of their own abode, everybody has this little thing inside them that says, oh, they don't like me. So his purpose was not to be liked by the majority. It was to offer the ultimate sacrifice, his own life, that all could worship God in freedom and truth. You shall know the truth, the Bible said. John writes, and the truth shall what? Make you free. Whether the people approved or disapproved, recognized or had no awareness what was going on, Jesus' purpose never changed. Never changed then, doesn't change today. It's the same yesterday, today, forever. And today we sit here in South Swansea Baptist Church in this building set apart for the teaching and preaching of God's Word. And today, sitting here, we have the privilege of hindsight. We see what the disciples did not. We know the end of the story. We come alive to his life, which was dedicated to God's ways, ways that are far above ours and ways that are far beyond our own. I think the words of Isaiah were appropriate then, they're appropriate today. Isaiah 55, 8 and 9, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. God sent his son Jesus to earth in a way we never would have imagined. God sent his son Jesus to earth in a way we probably never would have chosen. Jesus came to us in humility. Jesus then lived among us and sacrificed everything in obedience to the Father. And if you ever forget that, and I would direct your attention back to probably the most famous verse in Scripture, certainly the Bible in miniature, John 3:16. For God so loved the world, right? That he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And some of you know that verse better than you know the back of your hand on the page. But how many of us truly know it in our hearts? Because that's what matters most. So his life purpose was to bring God's love and life to the world. His love bridged the gap. It still does today. His love provided a way for us. It still does today to enter the holy presence of God. So if you're sitting here this morning wondering, you say, preacher, well, I'm saved and I've trusted Christ and one day I'm going to be with him. If you're wondering what all this means for you, there is still an invitation here for us, all of us. Romans 6:23 reminds us, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. I would challenge you to tear that verse apart, unpackage it, and see how it speaks to your heart. If you're here this morning and you've never trusted Christ, that verse is for you. If you're here this morning and you've trusted Christ, that verse is equally for you. He loves each one of us and invites us into a relationship with him. That's what Romans chapter 10 is all about, right? In Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10, God simply says this in the word, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in your heart that God had raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. With the heart, one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. So let's think about this again. He loves each one of us and invites us into a relationship with him. That relationship is not only important in the fact that we come to Jesus Christ as Savior, but that relationship is even for the saved, the here and now, for each of us who know him. How do we live for him today? What is he speaking to our life today? And then a good summation point of this invitation is Romans 10:13. Whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So, if you do not know Jesus Christ this morning, I would challenge you. I would plead with you to turn your life to him. You know Jesus Christ this morning? My plea is equal. Because if we're reminded in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 10 that we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand, and notice that we should walk in them. The Apostle James, standing up here this morning, if he was, he would say to you, do you consider yourself saved? Do you consider yourself to be a Christian? He'd say to you, prove it. Prove it. Are you? Do you? But see, that's a message that we find here in Palm Sunday leading up to Resurrection Sunday. So, that's as far as we're able to go this morning. But I just want to encourage you for Christ. Give him your heart. And Christian, give him your life. So, let's pray together. And I'm going to ask Brother Keith, would you pray, please?